frost holds out at Arnhem Bridge from the 17th right the way through to the 21st. And what we see as a result of this tenacity and this bravery for the whole division is the award of 4 Victoria Crosses and hundreds of other decorations for bravery.
And I think it's remarkable just how long they managed to hold on in that position, and it's why it's still celebrated as a great feat.
The German capture of the Arnhem Bridge may not have been inevitable if the situation to the south had evolved differently. The American airborne forces had performed extremely well, despite their mobility being hampered. The road to Arnhem was reserved for the British, so American paratroopers were compelled to move out across country. But by the 20th, all the American target bridges had been taken, including the mighty road bridge at Nijmegen. This giant construction was finally captured the day before the fall of Arnhem Bridge, and only after a magnificent operation in which the Americans joined forces with their British allies. That day, the 20th, saw the 504th Parachute Regiment of the US 82nd Airborne Division cross the river in storm boats, despite the closest attentions of enemy gunners. Having succeeded in crossing, they paused only to signal their success across the water and began to fight their way towards the northern end of the bridge. At that point, British Army intervened. Over the previous 3 days, General Horrocks had led his 30 Corps from Joe's Bridge north along the road known as the Club Route. By Tuesday, the spearhead of 30 Corps had reached Nijmegen. But it was Wednesday at 6 o'clock when the first British tanks began to cross the bridge. What followed was a moment of high drama that can rarely have been rivaled in the history of war. Field Marshal Mordell had issued specific orders that the bridge should not be blown. It would be too valuable in the event of a German counteroffensive. But Brigade Führer Hamel had decided to disobey his orders and set up the explosives to blow the bridge. As the tanks made their crossing, he gave the order to detonate. But the charges failed to go off. Nijmegen Bridge, just 10 miles from Arnhem, was in Allied hands. But it had all taken time. General Gavin had arrived here on the first day of the operation, but was prevented from crossing that day and the next by stiff German resistance. When the British arrived from the south on the Tuesday, the way north was blocked and would remain so until the bridge was eventually taken. Subsequent progress was also slow. The battle-weary guards could not advance further that night without infantry support, and it was Thursday morning before the Irish and Welsh guards set off towards Arnhem.
The Americans, who had gone to so much trouble to capture the railway bridge and the other traffic bridge as well, were livid.
When the British finally captured the Nijmegen Bridge, there were no German forces between it and Frost, who still at that time had remnants holding out on the bridge at Arnhem.
They didn't know there wasn't a single German. But there was a question that the Grenadier Guards division had to stop for refueling, and they said they didn't have enough infantry, so they stopped for the night. And if they hadn't done that, they would have reached Frost, certainly.
News of the capture of Nijmegen Bridge boosted the morale of Urquhart and his surviving troops, who had now drawn themselves into a pocket at Oosterbeek, to the west of Arnhem. British heavy artillery fire could now be deployed from the south against the encircling Germans to the north.
They started firing, supporting us on the southern side of the Vaal at Nijmegen, and it was very heavy firepower they could give us. But couldn't always do that because ammunition supply had its problems because the route was cut by the Germans on 2 occasions. I think we'd gotten down to 3 rounds a gun at one stage, but then ammunition fortunately came through and so we continued.
It was not a moment too soon. Thursday saw the Germans capture the high ground at Westerbirving to the west of the British pocket. That afternoon, the Polish paratroopers also arrived.
They land into terrible conditions. The Germans have the Westerbowing Heights. They're mortaring and machine gunning the Poles whilst they're still in the air, and immediately they get on the ground. And it's a horrendous situation for the Poles.
Sosabowski was quick to get into the fray, deploying his 500 men to the immediate south of the Lower Rhine at Driel. Immediately, the Germans responded by placing 2,500 men between Sosabowski's troops and the British position. The Poles would have to cross the river to give support to Urquhart in the pocket. On Friday the 22nd, 30 Corps made further efforts to advance the final miles to Arnhem, but found itself held back once more. At Elst, the combined efforts of the Irish Guards and the British 129th Brigade failed to break through the German lines. The 214th Brigade and the 43rd Division were also deployed, but only one battalion from this latter division succeeded in joining up with the Poles, along with a small armoured detachment of the Household Cavalry. Urquhart and his men remained encircled on three sides. Now, they too began to suffer, as their manpower and their supplies began to dwindle.
It was a case of scrounging through the houses, of getting whatever you could get. Some of the supplies that actually were dropped opened the big panniers, and you found berries and cap badges and underclothes. It wasn't food or ammunition or water or anything like that. They were still working on Plan A, which was to invade Germany. And after the fifth and sixth days, they were still dropping stuff for the grand triumphal entry into Germany, capture Germany.
That night, on the banks of the Lower Rhine, the Poles attempted to cross the river in small rubber boats in a brave mission of support for their British allies. Frustrated for so long, they now showed their enormous courage as they took to the water in the full face of withering German fire. Of approximately 50 men who made the crossing, 35 made it to the British positions on the north side. On Sunday the 24th, a crossing attempt was made by the men of the Dorset Regiment, who had fought their way to the river. It too resulted in substantial loss of life, although a Polish crossing that night got 200 troops safely to the other side. Urquhart's forces were only able to hold their position because of artillery support from the south.